Testing, testing. All right. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you guys enjoyed the break. Hope you guys were able to fill out some of the evaluations and thank you cards. I do want to begin and introduce our next speaker here. But before I do, I will segue into there by first giving a shout out to one of our strongest Young Americans for Freedom chapters at the Catholic University of America. They actually were founded on today, just last year. Like many of you have faced, and many of you will face, I do know, the CUAF chapter did have to deal with a considerable amount of obstacles that prevented them from existing on campus, but nonetheless, they continued to persevere and push back, and like Jack said, they didn't take no for an answer, and I would encourage you guys to be like CUA. Certainly meet with some of their YAFers. Raise your hand back there. Let's go ahead and just give them a round of applause, because they did a good job. Meet with them and follow their social media. They have probably the best social media account of our YAF chapters. But the speaker who's going to be speaking next will be very, very helpful in helping you guys understand how to advocate for your conservative ideas on your campuses. Patrick J. Reilly founded the Cardinal Newman Society in 1993 and serves as its president and CEO. The Newman Society promotes and defends faithful Catholic education by recognizing exemplary Catholic schools and colleges and by advocating for the Church's vision for authentic Catholic formation. Reilly has authored and edited many articles, reports, and other publications on Catholic education. He's appeared on EWTN, Fox News, MSNBC, and numerous radio programs. Prior to the Newman Society, Reilly served as editor and researcher fellow at Capital Research Center, executive director of Citizens for Educational Freedom, higher education analyst for the U.S. House of Representatives, program analyst at the U.S. Department of Education, media consultant for the U.S. Conferences of Catholic Bishops, and chairman of American Collegians for Life. Rest assured, he is very qualified to speak. Reilly develops and teaches courses in logic, rhetoric, and philosophy for the Aquinas Learning Homeschool Program, founded by his wife Rosario. He's an advocate of faithful Catholic scouting, serving as committee chairman and former scoutmasters of his son's Boy Scout troop. Reilly has received many awards, including the awarded the Lumen Vitae Medal in 2018 from the University of Mary and the Hall of Fame Award in 2009 from the Catholic Education Foundation. He and his wife Rosario are proud parents of five children. Please join me in welcoming Patrick Reilly.
Does it sound good? Yes. Everyone hear me? Great. Okay. Can I see a show of hands just so I have a sense of where everyone's at? How many of you are high school students? Oh, wow. So it's mostly high school students. Okay. How many of you are college students? Okay, great. How many of you are at Catholic schools? Okay, the vast majority. There's some that are not, I assume. Okay. Good. Okay. Great. So just gives me a sense of everything. For those of you who are not familiar with the Cardinal Newman Society, I'm not going to talk about it, but I'll just introduce it very quickly. We promote and defend faithful Catholic education, seeking a renewal of strong Catholic education, particularly with regard to Catholic identity. So, as I'm told by a number of the foundations that like to support places like Young America's Foundation, we're not a conservative organization in the sense of, you know, our focus isn't politics. Okay, but especially in light of what conservative politics are today, you know, we certainly fall within the social conservative realm, and unofficially fully conservative. I fully support everything that YAF does. And given that you're coming from a Catholic perspective, I thought it would be good to talk to you today about fidelity and freedom in Catholic education. Okay, so I'm going to be talking specifically about Catholic education, but also education in general. So it should be relevant to everybody. This won't have a lot of relevance to you. Today's October 3rd. Tomorrow is October 4th. It's it's my dad's birthday, and my dad died 23 years ago. Now he died very young, and It used to seem a lot older to me, but I'm about 3 years away from the age when he died, and so it's been on my mind a lot. And you know, as I was thinking about this conference and about Catholic education, I was remembering a letter that he wrote to me just at the end of my senior year in high school, talking, you know, as I'm ready to head off to college, and just really talking about his faith and how important it was in his life, and how important it will be in my life, and to always, you know, to always remember that there's always someone to go to, there's always God. And that's always been a special letter to me, especially now that he's not here in physically. And so, you know, always knowing to rest back on prayer, to rest back and to know that God and our Holy Mother are there for us at all times. My dad was somewhat appalled at my choice of college. I went to a Jesuit university in New York City. I'd like to say he was appalled that it was a Jesuit university, but he wasn't. It was the location. It was in a rather rough neighborhood of New York City. And I remember as we were moving into my freshman dorm, and I was working with my mom, you know, kind of unpacking things and moving things around and setting things up. You know, moms like to be part of that. And my dad was looking out the window and watching a bunch of guys strip a car down in broad daylight, taking all the tires off, the fenders, the hood, everything they could get off of the car, as he's sitting there watching it from my dorm room window. He's asking me, why are you going to this school? Needless to say, I did not tell them until I graduated that about 2 weeks later, I actually watched someone getting shot right about a block off of campus. Someone had robbed the tropical fish store, and the owner shot him in the back as he was running out the door. So it was an interesting place, and I loved it. I really did. I thought it was exciting for me. You know, obviously, some things you had to watch out for. I also recall a few years later, I was in the journalism program. I became editor of the student newspaper. Very quiet, shy kid. I am, if you've ever taken the Myers-Briggs test, and it's, you know, introvert, extrovert, and all that. I took it in graduate school, and my teacher called me up after class and said, I really want to talk to you about this. I just don't want you to be really worried about your score. I'm thinking, okay, what am I supposed to be worried about? And my introvert score was off the scale, literally. And she said, it's okay. It's just, you know, you just learn to work with it. And I have. And so now here I'm doing this job, and I speak a lot, and I am very introverted, and somehow it works. But so I'm just throwing that out there because we're talking about being an activist, and I actually became something of a real thorn in the side at my institution because of the various scandals and dissent that were going on within this institution. And when I became editor of the student newspaper, I started to write a lot about it. And I'm thinking about my dad, I'm just remembering another situation where this was borderline okay, I think. We actually, Cardinal O'Connor was celebrating a mass at St. Patrick's Cathedral for celebrating the Catholic identity of our university. And we had had scandal after scandal after scandal, and we're trying to get his attention. And so we literally, not during the mass, but before the mass, were over in Rockefeller Center right across the street. And we were there with a bullhorn and signs, and I had a whole bunch of Operation Rescue people there yelling, and it was quite a scene for an off-the-scale introvert. And my parents knew about it, and my mom said, I want to come up for this. I want to see this. And so they came up, and they got there, and my mom picked up one of the signs and stood there with us protesting, which was quite unusual for her as well. And so that was kind of exciting. My dad told us, I'm going to take a walk around the block. And we saw him later. He was not totally comfortable with the whole thing. And to this day, I'm still not sure who was right. I mean, I think they were both right in terms of their response to this. Because on the one hand, we as Christians, we as human beings, have to respond to injustice, to falsehood, to deliberate attempts to push people into falsehood, especially young people in education. And we have to respond to this. We have to speak up. We have to say no. right? We have to not allow this to happen without our voices being aired and without trying to correct the situation. On the other hand, if this is, I deal with this now as an adult, and you're going to deal with this for the rest of your life if you're politically motivated, if you're called to parenthood, okay, your family is your first priority always. And any kind of activism or anything that pulls away from that, you have to say no, because there's a certain temptation to this that you just, you get riled up, you get driven, I'm saving the world, I'm changing the world, and this is more important than everything else. And you have to stay, have a strong prayer life, keep asking God, what is it I'm called to? And within that calling, to always be willing to stand up and speak up and do what you're supposed to do, okay? But, you can talk to people in all walks of life, it doesn't matter what their career is, but certainly within the political realm, within the nonprofit world, it's full of a lot of really good, honest, sincere, driven people wanting to change the world for the good, who in their own lives don't have the balance that they need. And so I always look back on that scenario of where, on the one hand, my dad was like, look, this is going too far. You're here for an education. I was on scholarship, and this university was threatening to pull my scholarship. And I'm doing all of this, and I was really driven and not focused on that enough. I didn't take advantage enough of being at a university and getting an education and forming myself intellectually and such. I did a lot of that after college on my own, and it's a lot harder. Right, so take advantage of what you have in education. You are at your high school or you're at your college to learn and to form and to be the kind of person that this society desperately needs. And that is somebody who knows how to think reasonably, rationally, who knows how to dialogue reasonably and rationally. We see so little of that today because people don't know how to do it. Right? So form yourself. Okay, get formed. And that's your priority. But while you're there, say no when you have to say no. Speak up, right? So it's a balance game that you're going to be playing for the rest of your life. So just keep that in mind. Now, all that is to say that I had my own personal share of college activism, albeit 30 years ago now. It's amazing how quickly the time goes. The topic of my talk is fidelity and freedom in Catholic education, because I've seen over and over again, and this is my job, is demanding faithful Catholic education. When that demand is made, the response that almost always comes back is no, academic freedom. Academic freedom is the buzzword that's going to shut you down in everything that you try to do on college campuses today. They're going to use that in every way possible to prevent you from doing what is right and just simply being able to speak your own position. Seems ironic, but that's the case today. Implicit in that statement, that somehow the argument for strong, faithful Catholic education is contrary to academic freedom, is this argument that somehow freedom and fidelity are at odds, okay? Or you could put it in terms of faith and reason. That somehow faith is a demand of people who want to control you, and freedom is an escape from that, okay? Actually, neither is true completely, and we're gonna talk about that, okay? So it's important to understand what is freedom, what is truth, what is education, what's it all about, what's the point of it. You need to know this in order to combat that argument. And so that's what I wanted to talk to you about today. And ultimately, these questions require, I know it gets philosophical, but these questions require an understanding of what is man, what is mankind, what is man's purpose. How does education help us to be fully human? If we don't know that and we can't answer those questions, I'm not going to put you on the spot. I was thinking of doing that. I do this with my classes. I teach philosophy and rhetoric and these other things. And every year, the first class I ask is, who are you? What are you? You know, if an alien comes down from Mars and looks at you and says, what are you? You say, oh, I'm human. Well, what's that? What is it? What makes us different from other animals? What makes us human? What makes us distinct? You should have an answer to that, right? Wouldn't you think? We can usually explain what a Republican is. We can explain what a conservative is. We can explain what a Catholic is, but we can't explain what a human is, right? This is so fundamental. And it's fundamental, it's especially important today because it's being attacked in so many ways. It's being destroyed, the fundamental understanding of what a human being is. So in the next, what time is it here? Okay. In the next 30 minutes or so, or less, I'm going to discuss these definitional questions, drawing heavily on Aristotle and St. Thomas Aquinas. Discuss the nature and purpose of education, drawing heavily on Aquinas and St. John Henry Newman, and then discuss the traditional and the new radical definitions of academic freedom. And if I can do that in less than 30 minutes, I want a lot of applause and maybe a medal. So we'll see if I can do this. Obviously, I will not have much time to explain all of this deeply. I'd like to answer your questions to the extent that I can, but you really need to, hopefully you'll be getting this in your schools, you really need to study Aquinas, Newman, all of this. I strongly recommend reading Idea of a University, but unfortunately it's often misunderstood. So, let's start. Baltimore Catechism. Any of you study the Baltimore Catechism at all in some of your stuff? Okay. Baltimore Catechism, why did God make you? God made me to know him, to love him, to serve him in this world, and to be happy with him forever in heaven. We are made. What is a human being? We are made in a unique way, unique from all other creatures, for communion with God. That's what a human being is. We are made for communion with God. That's what makes us distinct from every other creation. We're not simply created. We're actually made for a relationship with God. All things are united by creation. Everything's created by God, so all things are united to God in that sense, right? But, you know, I don't know, just think of a marriage or something, right? You can't marry someone who's, right, not fully human, right? You can't marry a robot, right, that functions like a human but doesn't have choice, doesn't have the ability to give of themselves, doesn't have the communications abilities, the everything that makes that comes into this being human, into this idea of communion, right? You can't have that kind of a relationship, and that's what God is calling us to. It is very similar, a marriage with God, right? A complete unity with God. We're given. So knowing, loving, serving God, right? These are parallel to the gifts that human beings have been given in order to fulfill this purpose of communion with God. So what are those gifts? Reasoning, right? We're given the gifts of reason. We're given the gift of free will. And we're given the gift of the ability to give of ourselves. You call it charity, you could call it self-gift, you could call it love. Right? These are three things that you cannot find another creature or anything in creation that is able to do any of those three things in the way that people can do it. I mean, there's arguments about how certain animals do a certain level of what we call reasoning, but what humans do is far beyond that. Right? Reason allows us to know, to have knowledge, to understand, right? To know God, to know goodness, to know truth, right? Free will allows us to choose it, to choose God, to choose goodness, to choose truth, okay? And self-gift charity is ultimately what is necessary in order to actually have true communion, right? So we do it with each other on a limited human basis, right? The height of that would be marriage, right? But ultimately, communion with God is something so much greater. When we say that we're made in the image and likeness of God, we're talking about these gifts which are analogical to God, okay, analogy. So God has reasoning. God has a mind. It's not quite like ours, right? But God, the world is designed according to God's reasoning. It comes through God's mind. God has, and truth, if we understand that, then truth, the truth in the world that we're seeking, is not simply knowledge about creation, right? Ultimately, truth is the mind of God. Okay, ultimately, truth is the mind of God, and that's more than just facts and figures and information. That's actually the will of God, right? This is all wrapped up in truth. The truth of the world, the truth of our lives, truth of creation is the mind of God, okay? Freedom. God certainly has freedom. He's not determined by anything else, right? God has complete freedom in a way that no creature fully has because we are created. He's not. And then finally, self-gift, okay? Our self-gift to each other is reflective of the self-gift in the Trinity, right? So the three persons of the Trinity, right? Always giving, 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 giving to each other. It's a full communion of the three persons of the Trinity. God himself is a communion, okay? So all mankind is equally called and working together toward God in communion. So we have communion with each other, all leading toward communion with God. Okay? That's the Catholic understanding of man. And it's extremely important to understanding freedom, and I'll explain why. What divides Catholics from the secular world and from the Protestant world, many Protestants, is this understanding that human dignity, what makes us special, what makes us human, arises not directly from our gifts, but from our purpose, right? Our human dignity arises from our purpose that God is calling us to communion with him. He gave us these gifts for that purpose, and those gifts are ordered toward that purpose, okay? It's not simply that mankind is special because we have free will. We can make all of our own choices. Well, yes, but that gift was given to us for a purpose, and it's that purpose that makes us special, okay? And when we turn that purpose in a disordered way, we become much more like animals, right? We become much more, much further away from God and much less human, okay? John Locke, I'm sure you've heard that name. I mean, John, much of American understanding of freedom, liberty, everything was drawn from him. Great insights, great man, but there actually are some distinctions between his understanding of freedom and the Catholic understanding, because his came largely from a Protestant mindset. And let me explain what that means. So John Locke wrote about religious freedom, okay, specifically about the freedom of religion. And he said that man's dignity is in the fact that we have free will. We're unique among all creatures because we have free will. Therefore, we need to respect that gift, and therefore, we need to allow the utmost freedom. That was his argument for religious freedom. Pretty good. However, what it leads to is this understanding of religious freedom as a civil right. Okay, religious freedom is a recognition of this gift, and it's a recognition by the government of this gift, and therefore, we're going to allow you the utmost freedom in religion. So it becomes a civil right. And it also becomes a negative right. Okay, I don't mean negative in a bad sense, but a negative right is one where we're talking about freedom from something, right? So the freedom of religion is a freedom from restrictions on our religious activity. There's no concept in this about what is true or not true, what is good or not good, right? And so therefore, anything labeled religion suddenly gets lumped under this freedom of religion. I did a lot of work years ago. You mentioned that I worked at Capital Research Center. I did a lot of work studying If any of you ever heard of the Reverend Jesse Jackson, he was one of the early civil rights leaders and then went on and built up this whole empire, nonprofit empire organization that was pushing, you know, very liberal policies and such. And everything was couched under his church. He got complete, you know, tax-exempt status for everything that he did, even very political stuff, even hosting candidates and doing all that. And he got away with all of it because he was a church. And he didn't have to report any of his finances or anything to the government. So no one ever knew what was happening there because he simply called it a church. And that's the problem with this understanding of religious freedom. Dignitatis Humanae, which is the Vatican II Declaration on Religious Freedom, talks about the Catholic understanding. It's different. And it's this little nuance where the Catholics understand that human dignity arises from our purpose in communion with God. Right? Our gifts are given to us for that purpose. Human dignity does not arise from the gifts themselves. Okay? And therefore, those gifts are rightly ordered toward God, toward communion with God, toward truth. Okay? Therefore, religious freedom is a positive right that's inherent in our dignity. Our dignity is to have, you know, to lead toward communion with God, and therefore religious freedom is necessary for that purpose. And so it's a natural right inherent in our very understanding of who we are. And it's a right to become fully human in activities that are ordered toward truth, goodness, and God. So therefore, a Catholic understanding of religious freedom would not necessarily protect religious activities that are knowingly false. I mean, it would allow for, you know, the error of you know, human reason, right? But it would not allow for activities that are actually directly opposed to God, directly opposed to communion with God, Satanism, right? It would not understand that as something that should be protected by religious freedom. Now, what about freedom in education? First, we need to understand what education is, okay? So again, I'm going to give you a crash course on philosophy. I know this is a lot. How do we know things, okay? Aristotle talked about three different steps, three different acts of the mind. Simple apprehension, where we experience something and we develop an idea of it, okay? We experience it through the senses. Judgment, where we relate those ideas together, okay? Basically creating some kind of sense of order and relation of things, right? That's not just a jacket, but it's a blue jacket. That's not just a tie, but it's a green tie. Whatever, you know, that understanding of judgment. And then reasoning is this higher level where we're actually able to take, and this is something very special to humans, we can take a judgment, we can take something that we know about something, we can put it together with something else that we know, and we come up with something completely new. We come up with a whole new judgment without ever experiencing it. So I talk to my students, I say, you know, if I show you a picture of a bunch of penguins sliding down an ice slide in Antarctica, and I say, what do you think, is it cold there? And everyone's gonna say, well, yeah, of course it's cold. Well, who's been to Antarctica? Not a single one of them, okay? But we use our reasoning. We know that when we look at that, that's ice, or it sure looks like ice. That's, sometimes these things can be deceived, but we look at that and we say, okay, that's ice, it's gotta be cold there. Right? So this is that's a very basic example, but we're able to use reasoning to come to higher and higher and higher understandings of things without experiencing them at all, but just knowing that this must be true because that is true. And this is something that maybe on a very limited level, but not on the level of humans, that other animals might be able to do, but we can do in such a great way. And it's powerful. It's amazing. Right? So why don't we exercise it? Why don't our schools exercise it? Why do they just flood us with tons of information, pack their heads with as much information about chemistry and physics and science and what we think is important in history and make them read as much as possible so they learn skills. If they got skills and facts, send them off and they're going to be good workers, right? That's our understanding of education today, not cultivating this great gift of reason that's far more important and far more powerful. Ways of learning, okay? So we certainly learn by experience. We experience things by our senses. okay? And we generally trust our senses, but they can be flawed. Reasoning, right? So then we take those things and we can learn new things by reasoning, like we just talked about. And then testimony. And this, again, is something that our modern culture has completely rejected, right? This anti-authoritarian movement that has come through the last several decades has gotten to the point where we simply don't trust what anybody else tells us, right? And so everything's experiential. We're going to figure it out, and we're going to make you figure it out for yourselves, right? And otherwise, don't trust it unless it's something that's really physical and something that you can just trust because, you know, it's easy to see, it's or whatever. But the higher levels of reasoning, where we take abstract concepts and we try to understand God and we try to understand goodness and justice and all of these things, don't trust what anyone tells you. Come up with it on your own. That's what we're telling people. And yet, the reality is that not a single human, if they took all of the knowledge that's what they consider to be knowledge in their mind, has maybe 1%, if that, in their mind that are things that they actually experienced, right? We learn by testimony. We trust sources, and there are ways of determining what are trustworthy sources, but that's what we do, right? That's how we, together, working out our communion together, work toward actual truth. Think if Einstein couldn't ever communicate what was in his head. Think if any of the great political philosophers could never communicate what was in their head, could never share it. So they came up with something and then they died and they couldn't share it, right? So rhetoric, communication, is part of that self-gift. It's a self-gift of our reasoning to share that with each other. And again, we need to develop that ability of communication. Do everything you can to learn how to speak well, to write well, because this is the human ability of sharing what's in our minds with other people in a way that they understand and embrace what we're saying, okay? Newman's idea of a university talks about the unity of knowledge, okay? All knowledge is united in God's mind and united by his creation. Everything's created by God, so there's a certain unity to everything. It's also true that all knowledge is related to each other, okay? There's really one whole knowledge, okay? That's a Catholic understanding of knowledge. There aren't these separate truths. Everything's related to each other, and everything's part of this one whole truth. Now, we human beings, as part of our process of judgment, we tend to break these things up into branches of knowledge, right? So you've got history, you've got math, you've got all these things, right? They're all related, but we're organizing knowledge in different ways. That's what the branches of knowledge are, okay? It's really a human abstract construct, okay? And running through all of this is everything, is God and his truth, okay? So this is why Newman says, you can't have a genuine education, you can't have a genuine university that rejects theology, that rejects God, that rejects the truths about God, okay? Now, a lot of what we know about God is based on faith, and some people have some different ideas, and so different people are going to have different ideas about God. But if you're not taking what you know about God and running it through every single thing that you study, right? What is math? Math is the order of the world as God created it, right? It's not just a bunch of numbers and processes that someone came up with, right? What are all of these? Every discipline you study, God, theology runs through all of it. And so if you reject that, all of a sudden, you start to get all of this balkanization, this fragmentation of knowledge where, well, this is this type of knowledge, this is this type of knowledge, and they don't relate to each other. That's simply not true. That simply doesn't relate to actual truth. We understand that truth ultimately is God's mind, right? So thus, the university, the whole point of why universities were established, and by the way, the first universities were established by the church directly or under the auspices and support and sponsorship of the Catholic Church, okay? Because of this understanding of the unity of knowledge. University is universal. The idea was to bring together, they used to have all these schools of theology and schools of sciences and all of these things, and they said, no, let's bring it all in one place, so that we can have an integrated education, so that we can understand that, yeah, you specialize in history, but you're talking to philosophers and you're talking to theologians, and all of it relates to each other. That was the whole point of a university. And we've completely gone the other direction now with most of the research universities. Right? That's false. That's false education. So specialization is good. You can't know everything. So it's better to dive deeply into a particular area and to say, you know what? I'm going to dedicate my life to this type of work, right? But fragmentation is not. Rejecting the whole of truth and not understanding that it's all related and not being eager to talk to people who are specialists in every other area is bad. Make sense? Okay? So Aquinas talked about education, teaching. And he said, in order to teach someone, my wife always says, you can't learn someone, right? I can be telling you all of this right now, but it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon. You've heard a bunch of speakers. You're tired, right? Maybe you're getting hungry, right? And aside from that, there are a million other things going through your head about things that you're interested in, or maybe what you're doing later, or just a million different things that affect your reception of what someone's trying to communicate to you. Okay, so teaching requires an act of will by the learner. Okay, so I can teach, but I can't force that knowledge into your head. You actually have to have the appetite to hear it. You actually have to want it, and you have to grab onto it and think about it and process it and keep it. Otherwise, it's gone. Right? So that's how education works. And so free will, freedom, is extremely important in education. Right? A good education will allow the utmost freedom, as much as possible, to allow people to work out things, to communicate with each other, to dialogue, to talk about different ideas, to share, hey, I was thinking about this, what were you thinking about? And a lot of times it might be wrong, but by working together at things, we're more likely to get things right, right? Two of us are more likely to get something right than one, okay? Unless one of us is a complete dolt, which happens too. You'll find that a lot in any kind of political conversation, including the last debate. Anyways, we have to go back to the Catholic understanding. In a Catholic education, we understand this freedom to be a positive freedom. It's a freedom towards something. It's a freedom to allow you as the utmost opportunity to discover truth and to discuss truth, right? And to work together toward communion, okay? Things that frustrate that get in the way of that, okay, are a problem. And ultimately, ignorance, falsehood, is the worst kind of slavery. Okay, we've also gotten away from that idea, right? Slavery is something that somebody else is pinning on me. No. Slavery is being unable to get words out in the middle of a debate, or being unable to understand things that you're talking about or wrestling with, right? Slavery, the worst kind of slavery is falsehood and ignorance. Okay, and so we're always trying together to work our way out of that. But if someone interferes that process, then it's not good for Catholic education. The purpose of the university is education, and therefore, if people are acting boorishly, not allowing for a genuine dialogue, acting hatefully, deliberately distorting the truth and trying to be manipulative in the way that they talk about things, or knowingly teaching falsehood, is a violation of freedom. From a Catholic understanding, it's not freedom. It's liberty, right? So kind of the libertarian understanding of, look, we just need complete ability to do whatever we want to do, and we'll work it out among each other, right? That is not a Catholic understanding of freedom, especially as it applies within a Catholic university. Freedom is an important condition for intellectual activity. But Catholic education is not ordered to freedom. Catholic education is ordered to truth. And ultimately, that's the priority and sometimes our liberty has to be restricted in certain ways in order to help move everybody toward truth. So Newman says, essentially, education's purpose is knowledge and cultivating the intellect. Right? It's not the primary, the essential purpose of education is not religious. Right? The church's goal is to evangelize, to teach you faith, right? To form you morally. The essential purpose of education is intellectual development. However, because learning depends on your appetite, on free will, on choosing the good and moving toward truth, therefore, he said, quote, practically speaking, it cannot fulfill its object duly, such as I've described it, without the church's assistance. Or to use the theological term, the church is necessary for its integrity. So he literally goes on to argue that a secular university lacks integrity. It's missing the thing that brings everything together, integration. It's missing, if truth is a whole, it's missing that understanding because we've lost the condition that makes it a whole, right? By denying God or simply rejecting discussion of him. And the church is necessary for its integrity, not only because theology enters into every discipline, or faith enters into every discipline, but because moral formation, virtue are needed in order to ensure that our intellectual activity is always moving toward truth, toward the good. Okay? So therefore, in Catholic education, we say that we promote an integral education, which is a formation not just of the intellect, but of the soul, of the conscience, moral formation, right? This is important to Catholic education, not necessarily because it's essential to education per se, but because it's necessary to education, okay? Academic freedom. So the AAUP, the American Association of University Professors, in 1940 issued the classic understanding in the United States of academic freedom. It said, teachers are entitled to full freedom in research and in the publication of the results, subject to the adequate performance of their other academic duties. Teachers are entitled to freedom in the classroom in discussing their subject, but they should be careful not to introduce into their teaching controversial matter which has no relation to the subject. And then as scholars and educational officers, they should remember that the public may judge their profession and their institution by their utterances. Hence, they should at all times be accurate, should exercise appropriate restraint, should show respect for the opinions of others, and should make every effort to indicate that they are not speaking for the institution. Okay, that is not the modern radical understanding of academic freedom. Okay, today, academic freedom is generally used to say that I have a right to do pretty much anything I want as long as I'm employed as a professor. Okay, and it's even largely been applied to students as well, to say that students have a certain academic freedom to do pretty much anything they want and say anything they want and act in any way that they want on campus. Okay, it's become a complete liberty that's no longer tethered to truth or to the mission of the university to seek and teach the truth. Okay, this 1940 document wasn't exactly how I would have written it, but underneath it you can see an emphasis on truth, right? Accuracy. You can teach whatever you want, but it's got to be truthful, right? If you're teaching history and you're teaching falsehood to students, that's not protected by their statement on academic freedom. If and again, there's allowances for mistakes. There's a difference between mistakes and actually deliberately taking a position that at least through established thought and through general respected historians would be considered completely false. Okay. Now you would say, well, shouldn't there be some allowance for even that? You know, sometimes radical ideas that everyone rejected suddenly turn out to be true. Okay. That needs to be done within the academic community, within academic conferences, within writing and other things. It should not be done in the classroom when the purpose of the teacher in the classroom is to teach truth and to help you find truth. And therefore, you should not be, you know, moving far away from that. And that in a Catholic university, that's especially important with regard to theology, with regard to faith, right? in a Catholic institution, what the church teaches, what was revealed to us by Christ, is true. We embrace this. This is what makes us Catholic. A Catholic institution is a place where there's a shared understanding that that is true. And therefore, when I go study at a Catholic university, I have the utmost freedom to apply that and to explore that and to use the insights of my faith to understand every other discipline in a way that I never could without it. Okay? There is no discipline that doesn't benefit from the insights of our faith. Okay? As long as you accept that faith to be true. Now, are those who don't accept it to be true? Yes. Okay? They don't want to be at a Catholic institution. Okay? But the idea, someone who doesn't accept it is going to see that as restrictive. You're restricting what I can say. You're restricting what I can advocate. And we're simply saying, just like every other university ought to do, we're not going to allow teachers to explicitly reject and deny truth, especially in the classroom. Okay? And we understand this to be true. So we're doing just like every other university ought to be doing. Okay? John Paul II, in Ex Corte Ecclesiae, which is the Vatican document, constitution on Catholic universities, said that the Catholic university guarantees its members academic freedom so long as the rights of the individual person and of the community are preserved within the confines of the truth and the common good. He said, academic freedom is the guarantee given to those involved in teaching and research that within their specific specialized branch of knowledge, and according to the methods proper to that specific area, they may search for the truth wherever analysis and evidence leads them, and may teach and publish the results of this search, keeping in mind the cited criteria, that is, safeguarding the rights of the individual and of society within the confines of the truth and the common good. Okay? Now, in practice, this can get a little bit messy, right? When you try to establish certain things as we're sure that this is true. Well, there is nothing that we're sure of that is true. The only thing that we're 100% certain is true is what Jesus told us. If you accept on faith that he was the Son of God. If you accept that, then you need no other evidence. What he told us is true. Okay, that's what people who don't have faith don't like about faith. Okay, but we're accepting it purely based on the testimony of the Son of God, right? But everything else, you know, what we establish as true eventually can change and we can gain new understandings, but it needs to be treated, you know, through the academic circles and not brought into the classroom where there are things that are widely viewed as false, right? Because the goal of the university is to move people toward truth. Okay, so I'll finish up with that, and we can do some questions. So Catholic education aims not for a negative freedom from restraint, which is typically how freedom is talked about in higher education today. It's just a freedom from restraint, right? The thing to remember is that academic freedom in a Catholic university is understood as a positive freedom to seek truth, to know truth, to discuss truth, to teach truth, because falsehood is the worst slavery. Newman had a beautiful description of what he wanted as the outcome of education. And this is what I hope you aim for in your education, no matter where you are. And throughout your life, you're going to have to keep working on this, read things that weren't assigned to you in classes. Most of my learning has happened since I graduated from college. Newman said, I want a laity not arrogant, not rash in speech, not disputatious, but men who know their religion, who enter into it, who know just where they stand, who know what they hold and what they do not, who know their creed so well that they can give an account of it, who know so much of history that they can defend it. I want an intelligent, well-instructed laity. I wish you to enlarge your knowledge, to cultivate your reason, to get an insight into the relation of truth to truth, to learn to view things as they are, to understand how faith and reason stand to each other, what are the bases and principles of Catholicism, and where lies the main inconsistencies and absurdities of the Protestant theory. You ought to be able to bring out what you feel and what you mean, as well as to feel and mean it. to expose to the comprehension of others the fictions and fallacies of your opponents, to explain the charges brought against the church to the satisfaction not indeed of bigots, but of men of sense, of whatever cast of opinion. And that's all I have for today. So thank you.
All righty, same as before, questions right here.
Hey, Mr. Reilly, my name is William, and I go to Bishop Ireton High School up in Alexandria by D.C. Uh-huh. So my question is, you mentioned two types of education, a career-oriented one versus a true liberal arts education, if you will. So my question is, how do we as students in a Catholic school try to shift our school from a more career-oriented one to one of like a true philosophical one?
Great question. I agree 100% with the goal, right? Let's do that. I do think that students need to realize their opportunity to make that kind of change at their institution is limited, right? That largely is going to have to come up through the faculty and such. But what motivates that? Faculty members need to hear from you that that's what you want, because most faculty members today don't believe that that's what students want. And sadly, I think a lot of students don't want it, right? So that is a reality. They need to hear from you. Talk to them. Say, you know, I really want more. Is there something we could do maybe even outside the class? Could a few of us do something more? And then that would be the other thing, is by example, right? There are ways of fostering an intellectual culture at a college or university that have nothing to do with what happens in the classroom, right? My vision of college when I was going off to college was kind of, you know, the group of five or six people sitting under the big oak tree having the philosophical discussion, and, you know, never happened in my time there, you know. We had some pretty good discussions over a beer in the local bars, but that was about it. And that was a shame, and I really lamented it. And now I look back on it, I'm like, you know, I had the opportunity to do something about that. You don't need a professor to build that intellectual culture. You can do that with other students. So finding others who are interested in that, you know, ways to find it would be to have a few activities, maybe a speaker or something, and then those people who come to that are going to be people who are interested, and talk to them and say, hey, would you be interested in doing something where we can have more interdisciplinary dialogue? You know, I would love to have a discussion about creation or about, you know, some of these big ideas that involve, you know, the physics students and the pre-law students and have everybody in the same room, because I don't get that opportunity in my classroom. So I would say that's your best way of, you can change the culture a lot easier than you can change the institution itself, but that alone will create an influence on the faculty where they might see that, okay, there's a hunger for this, maybe we could do more of it.
Thank you so much.
Okay, sure.
Hi, I'm Gabrielle Dan Kanich. I'm from the Catholic University of America. You mentioned briefly in your opening that you believed both your mother and your father were correct in their approach to the protest. How would you consider, or what is your best perspective on combating the corruption that is within the Catholic Church?
So I would say it's the same thing. I would say, look, you as a person are called by God to a certain life, okay? Now, there are some people who are just called to be leaders in these things and maybe not even have a family and not whatever and to do that, right? But you need to pray and understand, what is my vocation in life? And that's my first priority, okay? But there shouldn't be a single Catholic in this country who, whether they're tending to their family or whether they're in a religious life or, you know, they're very focused on their career, who isn't setting aside some amount of time in order to be actively involved in the building up of the church, in the building of the kingdom and evangelization, and trying to do it within their career path or within whatever they're doing. So I would, so again, you know, like as students, I would say your first priority is to be a student and to get formed, okay? But within that process, you have lots of opportunities, right, to be an example, to raise these questions, to do it in the classroom, outside the classroom, to write a letter to the editor of the student newspaper, to join a club and dedicate a certain amount of time to trying to improve the place and everything. I just caution against I think there's a temptation to make that everything and to neglect maybe some of the things that God's calling you to. So it's a lot of it has to come through prayer. I fully believe that there's certain, like say in politics, there are certain people who, you know, they're called to be focused on politics, and they have great minds, and they have whatever, and that's their primary emphasis because that's what God's calling them to. But I can't believe it's everybody, and so you have to really work that out. Just have that balance.
Hi. I grew up in Brooklyn, so the neighborhood you're describing sounds like around Fordham University.
Yeah, this is right the Bronx. Yeah.
Okay.
The Bronx.
My name is Nick. I go to Boston College. I'm a graduate student at Boston College. And I brought up the fact that I grew up in Brooklyn because I grew up probably different than some of the people here. I grew up pretty poor, and I didn't have the privileges accessible to me to go to a Catholic private school. My parents didn't have the money. So I was just forced or beholden to the public education that I got and kind of just went through K-12 through that system. And I guess my question is, how can we make this sort of formative classical education accessible to families and to children that are never going to probably even be aware of this sort of education that exists because of the fact that things have become so secularized? And they're kind of just entrapped in this system.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we have the internet and we have resources available to us, but you know, a lot of people are talking about school choice and yeah. waiver system and things like that. But how can we actually like practically do something to make this sort of education more accessible to people?
Right. Yeah, thanks. That's a great question, and it's a question, a subject I'm very passionate about. Absolutely, we need to do everything we can, right, to make it accessible to everyone. There's a nuance in terms of what does accessibility mean. For most people in Catholic education today, accessibility means making our current parochial school system available to as many people as possible. I have real questions to the extent which the parochial school system as it stands today, without having a large number of, you know, basically the free labor we had with the, you know, religious sisters available, how many people you can really get that to. I mean, it's a very, very small percentage of Catholics today who are getting that kind of education. And it's probably not possible. You can find ways to make it more available, but how widespread can you do it? So when we talk about accessibility, I think it's looking to new ways of doing it, right? And a lot of that is happening through homeschooling, right? Through a lot of different online options with hybrid options and supplemental education. To some extent, the CCD programs have gotten better, but CCD is just learning your catechesis, right? It's not a Catholic education where the faith is imbued throughout the entire curriculum and you're getting that strong liberal arts core, which is extremely important. And so there's a lot happening in that realm, but that's where it needs to happen. And we need you to get really well formed through your education now and then to go out there and start providing that, because it's happening slowly, but we need so much more of it. And we need to keep finding ways to make our parochial schools more affordable and better in terms of their education. So it's all of that together.
Well, thank you so much for coming to speak to us today. My name is Katrina Fee. I'm also from the Catholic University of America. And my question is specifically at my school, we have four courses of philosophy, classical philosophy required, and three courses of theology required. However, should you get a liberal professor for any of those key courses, the outcome can be absolutely on the other side. So what is your advice for students that are faced with this dilemma?
Give us the name of the liberal professor first. I have some people I can talk to. it happens. Okay, and this is the you're trying to do, you're focused on what's most important, but you run into these issues. And this is what I think, you know, the whole point of this is for most people is you've got to, when you're confronted with those things, you've got to speak up, you've got to say something, you've got to explain it. you know, I would certainly express your disappointment to those who are responsible for the hiring and the leadership within the institution and say, look, I came here, I really wasn't expecting, that's not what I thought I was getting in my education. Catholic U is an interesting place. We recommend it. They've got their policies down pretty well and everything, but there is, you know, there is that possibility, and there are those there who actually argue that that's a good thing, right? This idea that, well, we should have all different ideas and everything. That's, to me, that, you know, yes, you should be open to every possible different way of coming at things in the common project of learning and teaching truth, okay? But if you're doing it and you know that professors are not in keeping with the truth, then that's doing a huge disservice and, frankly, going directly against what the mission of the institution is. And so I think it's good to make that clear. I think it's good to write things in your student newspaper, not necessarily calling out the person by name, but saying, look, I'm experiencing this at this institution. I'm disappointed. I mean, the more you can get that voice across, the more the people who can really do something about it are there. I wouldn't recommend, in most cases, just like trying to get a professor fired or something like that, because it usually just doesn't, it ends up backfiring. The others rally around and everything, and they don't want students making those decisions, but you can come really close, and in extreme situations, you should do that. You should say, look, this person ought not to be here, and here's why. So use your reasoning, write something really well, and anytime you do write something, like for a newspaper or someplace, please have like 3 or 4 people read it and give their input and help you. Like, do it the best way you possibly can so that you're standing head and shoulders above the people who are making the opposite arguments.
Thank you.
Sure.
All righty, and this will be our last question.
Oh, yeah. Mr. Reilly, thanks again for coming. My name is Alex. I'm from Front Royal. Mm-hmm. And basically, I just had a more general question. And that's basically, sorry, it's so annoying, tying back to when you're talking about like Aristotelian logic and rhetoric.
Uh-huh.
And basically, we're supposed to use rhetoric to persuade people, right? Yeah. But people always latch on to their beliefs really emotionally. Uh-huh. And you know, you see that in like the allegory of the cave by Plato. So that said, I mean, I guess this, based on your experience, would you give any suggestions on how you can kind of give people the appetite to want to learn and engage in conversation with you and actually use rhetoric rather than just latch on to whatever they're already believing in?
Sure, absolutely. Yeah, so I literally just went through this with my rhetoric class. Aristotle defined rhetoric as the art of persuasion. It's just trying to persuade someone of something. Now, he actually believed that doing it reasonably and rationally and logically was the best rhetoric, right? We actually teach in our class that rhetoric is the art of communicating truth. And if you do anything else, especially deliberately, then you're doing rhetoric, you're using the techniques of rhetoric, but you're doing it in a disordered way. So it's going back to everything that I was talking about. Communication, the art of communicating with other people, right? If it's ordered rightly, is intended to help them. It's a self-gift. It's intended to either convey knowledge or to work out reasoning with someone else. That's rhetoric, okay? But we can act in a disordered way, and we can actually manipulate or turn people in the wrong direction. St. Augustine made a very, St. Augustine was trained in rhetoric, was a rhetoric teacher in his very secular days, and was basically a sophist. I mean, he was a rhetorician for hire, right? Orator for hire. He would go out there and speak and take any position you wanted him to take, and he would do it beautifully, and people would say, oh, yeah, great, I love that, right? So he was abusing rhetoric. And so when he converted and became a bishop, he was basically asked, you know, should we reject rhetoric? And a lot of people do because of the abuse of it. And he said, no. He said, you got to be careful about being overly dominating and manipulative with the techniques of rhetoric, but we should use eloquence. We should use ways of reaching out to people and their emotions in when we're evangelizing, when we're teaching the faith. And there was a great article that I wish I remembered where it's from that I could refer you to, but where this woman asks that very question about, you know, is there something wrong with using, tapping into people's emotions in rhetoric? And she said, Well, that would almost be tantamount to saying that our only relationship with God is on a logical level. It's only about truth, and it's not, right? Our relationship with God is actually self-gift, love. Emotion is wrapped up and ought to be wrapped up in our communion with God and with each other. This is how we were created. So emotion is very much part of being fully human. And so we shouldn't reject it, but we should do it in an ordered way, and we should connect with people's emotions in a way that those emotions lead them to the truth, that they're rightly ordered emotions, right? So we should help people to cultivate appetite for what's good, true, and beautiful. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with, nothing manipulative about raising a child and giving them good literature, good music, good art, right? That's not manipulative. That's teaching and training their appetite to want the good, and that's a good thing. So we do the same thing in rhetoric.
Yep. Thank you.